Oh, hi. Welcome back.
I think it's art time again.
Oh, hi. I'm Mark. I used to be a senior artist at Blizzard Entertainment, and now I teach art for a living. In this new episode of my award-winning YouTube series that I call YouTube Art School, I'm going to teach you how to pick great colors for your art. A lot of my students struggle with colors, and I'm sure you do too. If you don't, well, you do now, so pay attention. In just a couple minutes, you'll gain the color theory knowledge that will take your art to the next level. Professional advice for free.
Wow.
Quickly, let's get this class started. All right, class is in session. Pay attention. As I said today, we'll be learning about color theory. That sounds heavy, but if you've been a subscriber of mine, you know how these classes go. We take a complicated topic, break it down into a few easy to digest bites, and then profit. Instant knowledge, instant level up. Amazing. Before we do any of that though, I just said the class was free, but I was obviously lying. Don't be so naive. You're gonna have to pay the class fee of either one like or one sub. Most of you haven't been paying. What am I gonna have to do? Threaten you with free brushes? Fine, you're pushing me, so I have no choice. You can get a bunch of my main brushes right here in the top right corner of the screen and down in the description below. That's better. Let's get started. This class is a super condensed and simplified version of what I teach in my art program, but as a short YouTube video, I think you'll get a lot out of it, especially if you've been struggling with colors, or if you just want a quick refresher. We won't go into too much detail here because there's a lot to go over when it comes to color theory, and most of you have no attention span, but the next couple minutes should still provide a lot of knowledge you'll be able to apply directly, as in today, and instantly get better results. Moi, je trouve c'est un esti de bon deal, ça. We'll start with the basics, then look at a few of my favorite color recipes that you'll be able to try out, and then, finally, how to actually apply those successfully, because every recipe needs its set of instructions. Choosing the right colors is only half the battle. You gotta be careful how you use them. The chapters will be marked in the video timeline for convenience. And here we go. First thing, when we talk color theory, we gotta get on the same page regarding the basics. Let's start with the chromatic circle. This is the chromatic circle, and it's specific to the colors of light for digital art. Pigment colors have their own chromatic circle, but we're not interested in that today. Here we have all the colors of the rainbow. This is what white light is made out of. You add all of these together and you get the color white. What we see here though is only a fraction of all colors that we're able to use in art, because it only represents the hue of the colors. The hue is one of three properties of colors. The others are value and saturation. Very simply put, the values indicate how much black you're mixing in with the colors. Adding black doesn't impact the saturation, nor does it impact the hue. The color saturation then is how much white you add to the colors. Once again, it doesn't influence the other properties. You can change the saturation as much as you want, the hue and the values won't change, and you get the idea. By playing around with those properties, we're able to recreate all of the visible colors. Hue, value, saturation. Now, we should also talk about color temperature. There are colors that can be defined as warm colors and others as cool. That's cool. Usually, we'll split the chromatic circle this way to roughly indicate which color is cool or warm, but in reality, any color can take on any of the two roles. What? Here, for example, red. A typically very warm color. But what happens when another red is right next to it, yet is simply not as saturated? That red takes on the role of the cool color relative to the other red. Color warmth is relative, always. Remember this. Independently, those two are clearly red, a warm color. But relative to each other, we don't perceive them to be the same temperature. Why bother learning this? Because color temperature plays a huge part in composition. We're naturally attracted to warmer colors, and so they tend to get our attention more easily compared to cool colors. Think of it from the perspective of our genes, way back in the days when we were living in caves and our most advanced technology was fire. A warm color like yellow and red, aka fire, meant life. I heard that's very important. Thousands of years later, we're still slaves to our genes, and warm colors are just very attractive to our eye. As artists, we can use that to guide the attention to a particular part of a painting and not another, for example. I think about this stuff 1000% of the time when I'm painting. Now that we have the basics, let me show you a few color recipes that you can try right now, or as they could also be referred to, color harmonies. Basically, a way to select a few colors that will ensure that they work together, harmoniously. It's very easy to select colors that don't work together, like picking a bad team as the color team captain. A color harmony is a way to pick a great team all the time, or in this case, pick a good color palette all the time. There are many color harmonies, many more than I'll show today, but we'll look at three. Monochromatic, complementary, triads. Why those three? Because they're easy and I like them. For each of those three color harmonies, I'll show you two recipes, or color palette, that I think look very good, and ones that I also happen to use very often. Anyways, let's start as simple as it gets, a monochromatic color harmony. As the name implies, this palette will all be made out of the same hue, but not the same color. A monochromatic palette can look very ugly if you're too strict with it. What I like to do, to spice things up a bit, is first to vary the value and the saturation of the blue, like in this example, to get a lot more colors. And then I like to add an accent color to it. That's gonna be a different color, usually pretty vivid, like the yellow here. But in such a small quantity that it doesn't really affect the color harmony. You'd save this for some small details maybe. Like overall though, when you zoom out, this particular palette should still look like it's mostly all the same color. The next color harmony on the menu is complementary. You grab two colors, opposite on the chromatic circle, and that will make up the bulk of your palette. One color complementing the other. Once again, we can vary the value and saturation of our colors to get a more interesting recipe. And since we have two colors now, we should pick a leader. There should always be a leader, like a main character. For a monochromatic palette, the lead color will typically be the most vivid of the bunch, like a very bright and saturated blue in my previous example. But when we have two colors of complementary hues, we should pick which one will take on that lead role. That lead color will typically be used on and around the focal point of a painting, or whatever else you're slapping colors on, since its purpose is to attract attention. If you want people to look at a particular area of the artwork, use that lead color to guide the eye of the viewer where you want it to go. In this example, I chose the warmer of the two, the lime green, to be the leader. As a result, I'll desaturate the purple and try to make it less vivid as a secondary color. This will be used a lot on visual elements that are far from the focal point, areas that we don't particularly want to bring attention to. The last one, triads. Three colors picked at equal distance on the chromatic circle. Once again, same idea, we gotta pick a leader. Usually with a red, blue, and yellow triads like this, I almost always default to the red being the leader since it's naturally the most intense color of the entire chromatic circle. It makes a good leader. And well, let's spice this recipe up a bit again by putting the emphasis on the red and muddying up the other two colors. Now that I have these, let's play around with the hues a bit to get three more recipes. Ooh, very nice. Feel free to pause the video or take a screenshot so you can color pick from these, if it helps. And have fun with it. Don't be too strict. You don't need to only use these colors. Remember, you can always play with the values and the saturation. And of course, you can also select different colors from the chromatic circle now that you know different color harmonies. And now it's time to have fun. How do we actually use these recipes? These color palettes. Looks good in the bar like this, but unless we follow some guidelines, it won't transfer to the art too well. I mentioned it briefly before, but the main power that colors have is to guide the eyes of the viewer. It's a way to manipulate. We have recipes with lead colors to work with already. Usually, again, it's going to be the color that will be the most vivid, the one that stands out the most. And we'll want to focus those on and around our focal point. That should already be defined prior to adding colors, and in my case here, like for most character paintings, it's going to be the face of the character. If you're coloring an environment, well, it'll be whatever your focal point is then. The goal is always to arrange the colors that way. But what happens if you don't though? A bad example would be something like this, where the most exciting colors are found on the gloves and the dress. This almost forces us to focus on that first. The saturation and the brightness of the colors in this area act like a magnet for the eyes, except now it's pulling us away from the focal point. Stop it! Here I made a color variant for almost all six of my six color recipes as good examples. The original, first, not particularly following any of the recipes that I mentioned today. Still though, you can see the shoulders and the hair featuring more exciting colors than the rest, despite technically being cooler colors compared to the red dress. It's all relative. Here we have, oh, that bad example again. Then I have the monochromatic one. All blue with some small yellow accents. It's all blue, but the variety of values and saturation still makes it pretty aesthetic. I made sure to focus the more saturated blues around the focal point here, instead of doing something like this, where once again the attention drifts away from the focal point to focus on the gloves and the dress. If the gloves were the focal point here, then it would be a success, but it's not. Next, I have the complementary color recipe, with green as the leader and purple as the secondary color. Nice. Simple, but nice. Then the triads example. Red as the leader, with yellow and blue as the secondary colors. One of my favorites. Typical superhero colors too. Then I have two more. Another monochromatic version here, but in red this time. It looks pretty cool. I recommend monochromatic color palettes with a small accent color if you don't have much experience playing with colors. You just gotta make sure the area around your focal point features the more saturated colors and often the brighter colors, while keeping the desaturated and darker colors away from that. Then just slap on some accent colors around the focal point and you'll be golden. Finally, complementary colors again for fun. And that's going to be the end of this week's class. Now, go out there and color some stuff. Hope this was helpful. You know what to do if it was. Tell your friends, tell your doggy, yell it to your neighbors. They should all subscribe and learn art with us. We're so close to 700,000. Do it. Also, just for you on YouTube, I have a huge discount on my art program until the end of the month. Check it out. Oh.